What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. Testing is a vague word in software development. You see, there's a lot of different kinds of testing we can do. And to make it more specific, we'll need another word next to it. Some of the better known kinds of software testing are things like beta testing, which provides a nearly finished application to a group of users to see what problems they can come up with, very popular with games. There's performance testing, which makes sure that the application is running as fast as it should be, or at least as fast as it needs to be. There's stress testing, which is done to see how well the code works under heavy load. So, this web application works fine with one person, but what about 100 or 1000 at the same time? There are other kinds of testing too. We've got integration testing, regression testing, usability testing, and many more. Well, this series isn't about any of these. We'll be talking here only about unit testing. Testing we do as programmers, not as end users. So this is about us testing the individual units of our code, the smallest logical pieces, like classes and methods. We're proving that if we pass these particular values into that particular method, we will get this specific result back. And we go ahead and prove that this is true. The key part is that we will be testing our code as we write it. We might not have a user interface yet. We may not have written most of our classes yet. So this series is about unit testing, but more than that, it's about having automated unit tests. See, if you want to test down to the level of the individual methods in your application, you don't want to manually call this testing logic every single time and then check the results against some massive sheet of outputs. That would be painful. So we will automate this. We will write logic that tests our code. Then we'll have our application code and right alongside it, saved and considered as important, repeatable testing code. Now, that might sound like a huge amount of additional work. It really isn't. In this series, you will see that writing tests is done very simply and requires minimal code. We need it to be as easy as it can get, so we can run these tests 10, 20, or 100 times a day. Among other benefits, having automated unit tests allows us to easily validate that any change we make, whether that's tomorrow or 6 months later, did not break something we did earlier. So, with test-driven development, we're unit testing. But that's not all we are doing. There's one more idea we are missing. You see, unit testing is not the same thing as doing test-driven development. Don't get me wrong, having these automated unit tests, it's great. It's very worthwhile. And we will do those unit tests. But to do TDD, we have to take that idea one step further. So what is this step? Well, when most developers first encounter this idea, they make the assumption that first we would write a bunch of our normal application code, and then we would write our automated unit tests to check the logic that we just wrote. So, as an example, we might write a method called calculatePrice. Then, after we've written it, we think about creating a few tests. What kind of values might I pass in, and what results should I expect? And this is unit testing. But this is not test-driven development. TDD turns the process completely around. TDD suggests to first write the test, and then proceed with the application logic. Like, wait, what? How can we test a method we haven't written yet? This sounds counterintuitive. Well, you can. And in test-driven development, we do that all the time. We will write tests that attempt to instantiate an object where we haven't written a class for that object yet. We will write tests that call a method that doesn't exist, and we will run those tests, and the first time we run those tests, they should fail or might not even compile. But ultimately, we want the test to fail. And that's the core distinction between doing TDD and not doing it. Before we write any new code, we first write a failing test. And only after it fails, we write the application logic to pass that test. And we write the minimum necessary code just to pass this specific test. Hence the red-green refactor cycle you may have heard of. You see, if we wait till all of the logic is written before writing any test, we'd have to go through all the possible scenarios this method might need to do today and tomorrow and in the future. All of this speculative code that we're trying to come up with vanished. All we need to do now is just pass this one test. It keeps us focused. It gives us clarity on exactly what we're doing at one point. And this is what is meant by test-driven development. The tests drive our development. So TDD is not just development that uses unit tests. Test-driven development is a process and technique that focuses on the priority and position given to those unit tests. TDD shifts the idea of testing from an afterthought, from something that we do later, to something we start with and drives everything else we do. Now, before diving in unit test frameworks, I want to tell you that unit testing isn't here to replace all other kinds of testing and isn't intended to. Even in places where unit testing may not apply to 100% of our code, it may still be very worthwhile for 80 or 90% of it. Additionally, TDD is not about writing all your unit tests and then start writing your application logic, no. TDD consists of very small repeated steps. Writing a unit test should take the tiniest amount of work. Say you're about to write a new method. Pause, take a few seconds, think, how would I call this method to prove that it works? Or that it doesn't. And then write that test, verify it fails, and then start writing code to pass the test. Now, I know a lot of people out there refuse to work in a TDD mindset because, well, it can't be applied on everything and it doesn't fix all of your problems when it comes to testing. Well, it's true, it doesn't fix everything. So does object orientation, design patterns, agile methodologies. These two do not fix everything and can't be applied on all of your problems. But I guarantee that all of these skills are excellent to have. They're great for your development ability and amazing for your career. Okay, when we said that we are going to test our application via unit tests, you may have thought that, well, we'd need to write a brand new class and inside it create a method that tests this particular logic using a condition of some sort. Well, you could do this, however, it would be very monotonous and we will have to duplicate this code several times. So, what we do instead is use unit testing frameworks. Things like JUnit for Java, NUnit for .NET, UnitTest for Python. These are libraries of code, already written, already proven to help do automated unit testing. Now, you may assume that if you've learned how to unit test in Java and then had to switch over to C++, you'd have to learn a whole new approach to testing. But luckily, that is not the case. Because most of these testing frameworks are based on the same ideas, the same common ancestor, which is SUnit, developed by Kent Beck back in the 90s. And since then, if a unit testing framework is based on these original ideas, it is considered an XUnit testing framework. XUnit is this generic term to collectively group these SUnit, JUnit, OCUnit, CopUnit together, as coming from the same ideas. And it is the XUnit style of testing that we will be doing in this series. Now, are all unit testing frameworks XUnit? Well, no, they are not. XUnit style frameworks are by far the most common, but there are some competing ideas which we may discuss in the future. For now, for this series, you don't really have to worry about all the different options for all the different languages, as I will be using the most recent JUnit version when diving into any piece of code. Not only because the main language of this channel is Java, but also because unit testing is extremely common in the Java world. If you're a Java developer looking for a job, the expectation that you would know how to use JUnit is pretty high. You see, JUnit was the first unit testing framework to take the SUnit ideas to a wide commercial audience and really popularize them. The first books on test-driven development were Java-focused, so although the ideas originated in SUnit, most of the XUnit frameworks are really based on JUnit rather than the official ancestor. On top of this, most of the time you won't even need to download any library on your own, because most probably your IDE has built-in support for the most common unit testing framework for the language you are using. So, if I go to IntelliJ and Alt plus Enter on a class, one of the options that I'll find is to include unit tests, and it has full support for JUnit. Okay, with that said, we now know what is test-driven development, and when and why it is used. So, it is time we start creating a few unit tests using the TDD approach. And that's exactly what we will be doing in the next video of this series. So, stay tuned! And that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching, take care, and I will see you in the next one.